Recorded Books Incorporated presents an unabridged recording of The Burglar Who Painted Like Mondrian by Lawrence Block, narrated by Richard Ferrone. This work is copyrighted 1993 by Lawrence Block. This recording is copyrighted 1999 by Recorded Books Incorporated. For antiquarian book dealer Bernie Rhodenbarr, rare first editions are his pride, but illegal entry will always be his passion. A job appraising the private library of one Gordon Onderdonk, a Manhattan millionaire, gives Bernie the chance to check out the tempting personal holdings of the rich and famous. Hey, a man's allowed at least one vice, right? And now, The Burglar Who Painted Like Mondrian.
Chapter 1. It was a slow day at Barnegat Books, but then most of them are. Antiquarian booksellers, after all, do not dream of retiring to the slow and simple life. They are already leading it. This particular day had two high points, and as luck would have it, they both came at once. A woman read me a poem, and a man tried to sell me a book. The poem was Smith of the Third Oregon Dies, by Mary Carolyn Davies, and the woman who read it was a slender and fresh-faced creature with large, long-lashed brown eyes and a way of cocking her head that she must have learned from a feathered friend. Her hands, small and well-formed, unringed fingers, unpolished nails, held a copy of Ms. Davies' first book, Drums in Our Street, which the Macmillan Company had seen fit to publish in 1918. And she read to me. Autumn in Oregon. I'll never see those hills again, a blur of blue and rain across the old Willamette. I'll not stir a pheasant as I walk and hear it whir above my head, an indolent, trusting thing. I'm rather an indolent, trusting thing myself, but all the same I cast a cold eye on the philosophy and religion section where my most recent visitor had stationed himself. He was a hulking sort, late 20s or early 30s, wearing low fry boots and buttonfly Levi's and a brown wide-whale corduroy jacket over a darker brown flannel shirt, horn-rimmed glasses, leather elbow patches on the jacket, a beard that had been carefully trimmed. When all this silly dream is finished here, the fellows will go home to wear their fall rose petals over every street, and all the year is like a friendly festival. Something made me keep my eyes on him. Perhaps it was an air about him, a sense that he might at any moment commence slouching toward Bethlehem. Maybe it was just his attaché case. At Brentano's on the Strand, you have to check bags and briefcases, but my customers are allowed to keep them at hand, and sometimes their carry-alls are heavier upon departure than arrival. The second-hand book trade is precarious at best, and one hates to see one's stock walk out the door like that. But I shall never watch those hedges drip color, not see the tall spar of a ship in our old harbor. They say that I am dying. Perhaps that's why it all comes back again. Autumn in Oregon and pheasants flying. She let out a small, appreciative sigh and closed the little book with a snap, then passed it to me and asked its price. I consulted the penciled notation on its fly leaf and the tax table that's taped to my counter. The last hike boosted the sales tax to 8.25%, and there are people who can figure out that sort of thing in their heads, but they probably can't pick locks. God gives us all different talents, and we do what we can with them. $12, I announced, plus 99 cents tax. She put a 10 and 3 singles on the counter, and I put her book in a paper bag, fastened it with a bit of scotch tape, and gave her a penny. Our hands touched for an instant when she took the coin from me, and there was a bit of a charge in the contact. Nothing overpowering, nothing to knock one off one's feet, but it was there, and she cocked her head and our eyes met for an instant. The author of a Regency romance would note that a silent understanding passed between us, but that's nonsense. All that passed between us was a penny. My other customer was examining a buckram-bound quarto volume by Matthew Gilligan, S.J., The Cato Grammatic versus the Cinco Grammatic, it was called. Or was it the other way around? I'd had the book ever since old Mr. Litzauer sold me the store, and if I'd never dusted the shelves, it would never have been picked up at all. If this chap was going to steal something, I thought, let him hook that one. But he returned Father Gilligan to his shelf even as Mary Carolyn Davies went out the door with my demure little poetry lover. I watched her until she crossed my threshold. She was wearing a suit and a matching beret in plum or cranberry or whatever they're calling it this year, and it was a good color for her. And then I watched him as he approached my counter and rested one hand on it. His expression, insofar as the beard showed it, was guarded. He asked me if I bought books, and his voice sounded rusty, as if he didn't get too many chances to use it. I allowed that I did, if they were books I thought I could sell. He propped his attaché case on the counter, worked its clasps, and opened it to reveal a single large volume, which he took up and presented to me. Lepidoptery was its title, François Duchardin was its author, and old-world butterflies and moths were its subject matter, discussed exhaustively, I can only presume, in its French text and illustrated spectacularly upon its color plates. "The frontispiece is missing," he told me as I paged through the book. "The other 53 plates are intact." I nodded, my eyes on a page of swallowtail butterflies. When I was a boy, I used to pursue such creatures with a homemade net, killing them in a mason jar, then spreading their wings and pinning them in cigar boxes. I must have had a reason for such curious behavior, but I can't begin to imagine what it might have been. "Print dealers break these up," he said, "but this is such a desirable volume and in such good condition I thought it really ought to go to an antiquarian book dealer." I nodded again, this time looking at moths. One was a Cecropia. That and the Luna are the only moths I know by name. I used to know others. I closed the book, asked him what he wanted for it. $100, he said. "That's less than $2 a plate. A print dealer would charge 5 or 10 a plate, and he'd get that easily from decorators." "Could be," I said. I ran my finger over the book's top edge, where a rectangle enclosed the stamped words New York Public Library. I opened the book again, looking for a withdrawn stamp. Libraries do divest themselves of books, just as museums deaccession some of their holdings, though Duchardin's Lepidoptery hardly seemed a candidate for such treatment. "Those overdue charges can mount up," I said sympathetically. "But they have these amnesty days now and then when you can return overdue books with no penalty. It seems unfair to those of us who pay our fines without protest, but I suppose it does get books back in circulation, and that's the important thing, isn't it?" I closed the book again, set it deliberately into his open attaché case. "I don't buy library books," I said.
"Somebody else will."
"I don't doubt it.
I know one dealer who has his own withdrawn stamp."
"I know a carpenter who drives screws with a hammer," I said. "There are tricks to every trade."
"This book didn't even circulate. It sat in a locked case in the reference section, available by special request only, and because of its value, they found ways to avoid letting people have access to it. The library's supposed to serve the public, but they think they're a museum. They keep their best books away from people."
"It doesn't seem to have worked."
"How's that?"
"They couldn't keep this one away from you." He grinned suddenly, showing clean, if misaligned, teeth.
I can get anything out of there, he said. Anything.
Really?
You name a book and I'll lift it. I'll tell you I could bring you one of the stone lions if the price was right.
We're a little crowded around here just now. He tapped Lepidoptery.
Sure you can't use this? I could probably ease up a little on the price.
I don't do much volume in natural history, but that's beside the point. I honestly don't buy library books.
That's a shame. It's the only kind I deal in.
A specialist? He nodded.
I'd never take anything from a dealer, an independent businessman struggling to make ends meet. And I'd never steal from a collector, but libraries...
He set his shoulders and a muscle worked in his chest.
I was a graduate student for a long time, he said. When I wasn't asleep, I was in a library. Public libraries, university libraries. I spent 10 months in London and never got out of the British Museum. I have a special relationship with libraries. A love-hate relationship, I guess you'd call it.
I see. He closed his attaché case, fastened its clasps.
They've got 2 Gutenberg Bibles in the library of the British Museum. If you ever read that one of them disappeared, you'll know who got it.
Well, I said, whatever you do, don't bring it here. A couple of hours later, I was sipping Perrier at the Bum Rap and telling Carolyn Kaiser all about it. All I could think of, I said, was that it looked like a job for Hal Johnson. Who? Hal Johnson, an ex-cop now employed by the library to chase down overdue books. They've got an ex-cop doing that? Not in real life, I said. Hal Johnson's a character in a series of short stories by James Holding. He goes off on the trail of an overdue book and winds up involved in a more serious crime. Which I suppose he solves.
Well, sure, he's no dope.
I'll tell you, that book brought back memories. I used to collect butterflies when I was a kid.
You told me.
And sometimes we would find cocoons. I saw a picture of a Cecropia moth and it reminded me. There were pussy willow bushes near the school I went to, and Cecropia moths used to attach their cocoons to the branches. We would find the cocoons and put them in jars and try to let them hatch out.
What happened?
Generally, nothing. I don't think any of my cocoons ever hatched. Not every caterpillar gets to be a moth.
Not every frog gets to be a prince, either.
Isn't that the truth? Carolyn finished her martini and caught the waitress's eye for a refill. I still had plenty of Perrier. We were in the Bum Rap, a comfortably tacky gin joint at the corner of East 11th Street and Broadway, which made it just half a block from both Barnegat Books and the Poodle Factory, where Carolyn earns her living washing dogs. While her trade provides relatively little in the way of ego gratification, it's more socially useful than looting libraries. Perrier, Carolyn said.
I like Perrier.
All it is, Bernie, is designer water, that's all.
I guess.
Got a busy night planned?
I'll go out for a run, I said, and then I may bounce around a bit.
She started to say something, but checked herself when the waitress approached with the fresh martini. The waitress was a dark-roots blonde in tight jeans and a hot pink blouse, and Carolyn's eyes followed her back to the bar.
Not bad, she said.
I thought you were in love.
With the waitress?
With the tax planner.
Oh, Allison.
The last I heard, I said, you were planning a tax together.
I'm planning a tax, and she's planning defenses.
I went out with her last night. We went over to Jan Wallman's on Cornelia Street and ate some kind of fish with some kind of sauce on it.
It must have been a memorable meal.
Well, I've got a rotten mind for details. We drank a lot of white wine and listened to Stephen Pender sing one romantic ballad after another, and then we went back to my place and settled in with some Drambuie and WNCN on the radio. She admired my Chagall and petted my cats. One of them, anyway.
Archie sat in her lap and purred. Yubi wasn't having any. What went wrong? Well, see, she's a political and economic lesbian. What's that? She believes it's politically essential to avoid sexual relations with men as part of her commitment to feminism, and all her career interaction is with women. But she doesn't sleep with women because she's not physically ready for that yet. What does that leave? Chickens? What it leaves is me climbing the walls. I kept plying her with booze and putting the moves on her, and all I got for my trouble was nowhere fast. It's good she doesn't go out with men. They'd probably try to exploit her sexually. Yeah, men are rotten that way. She had a bad marriage, and she's pretty steamed at men because of it. And she's stuck with her ex-husband's name because she's established professionally under it. And it's an easy name, too. Warren. Her own name is Armenian, which would be more useful if she were selling rugs instead of planning taxes. She doesn't exactly plan taxes. Congress plans taxes. I guess she plans avoiding them. I plan to avoid them myself. Me too. If she weren't so great-looking, I'd avoid her and say the hell with it. But I think I'll give it one more try. Then I'll say the hell with it. You're seeing her tonight? She shook her head. Tonight I'll hit the bars. A couple of drinks, a couple of laughs, and maybe I'll get lucky. It's been known to happen. Be careful. She looked at me. You be careful, she said. A couple of subway trains whisked me home, where I changed to nylon shorts and running shoes and ducked out for a quick half hour in Riverside Park. It was mid-September, with the New York Marathon a little over a month away, and the park was thick with runners. Some of them were of my stripe, the casual sort who knocked off 3 or 4 sluggish miles 3 or 4 times a week. Others were in marathon training, grinding out 50 or 60 or 70 miles a week, and for them, it was serious business. It was thus for Wally Hemphill, but he was following a program of alternate short and long runs, and the night's agenda called for 4 miles, so we wound up keeping each other company. Wallace Riley Hemphill was a recently divorced lawyer in his early 30s who didn't look old enough to have been married in the first place. He'd grown up somewhere in eastern Long Island and was now living on Columbus Avenue and dating models and actresses and, puff puff, training for the marathon. He had his own one-man practice with an office in the West 30s, and as we ran, he talked about a woman who'd asked him to represent her in a divorce action. "And I went ahead and drew up papers," he told me, "and it developed that this dizzy bitch wasn't married in the first place. She wasn't even living with anybody, didn't even have a boyfriend. But she has a history of this. Every once in a while, something snaps inside her, and she finds an attorney and institutes divorce proceedings." I told him about my book thief, who specialized in libraries. He was shocked. "Stealing from libraries? You mean there are people who would do that?" "There are people to steal anything," I said, "from any place." "Some world," he said. I finished my run, stretched some, walked on home to my apartment building at the corner of 71st and West End. I stripped and showered and did a little more stretching, and then I stretched out and closed my eyes for a while. And got up and looked up 2 telephone numbers and dialed them in turn. No one answered my first call. My second was answered after 2 or 3 rings, and I chatted briefly with the person who answered it. Then I tried the first number again and let it ring an even 12 times. 12 rings comes to 1 minute. But when you're calling, it seems longer than that. And when someone else is calling and you let the phone go unanswered, it seems like 1.5 hours. So far, so good. I had to decide between the brown suit and the blue suit, and I wound up choosing the blue. I almost always do. And at this rate, the brown will still be in good shape when its lapels come back into style again. I wore a blue Oxford button-down shirt and selected a striped tie, which would probably have indicated to an Englishman that I'd been cashiered from a good regiment. To an American, it would be no more than a mark of sincerity and fiscal integrity. I got the knot right on the first try and chose to regard that as a favorable omen. Navy socks, scotch-grained black loafers, less comfortable than running shoes, but rather more conventional. And comfy enough once I'd slipped in my custom-made orthotic arch supports. I took up my attaché case, a slimmer and more stylish affair than my book thief's, covered with beige ultra suede and glowing with burnished brass fittings. I filled its several compartments with the tools of my trade, a pair of rubber gloves with their palms cut out, a ring of cunning steel implements, a roll of adhesive tape, a pencil beam flashlight, a glass cutter, a flat strip of celluloid, and another of spring steel. And, oh, a bit of this and a little of that. Were I to be lawfully seized and searched, the contents of that case would earn me an upstate vacation as a guest of the governor. My stomach did a little buck and wing at the thought, and I was glad I'd skipped dinner. And yet, even as I was recoiling at the idea of stone walls and iron bars, there was a familiar tingle in my fingertips and a racy edge to the blood in my veins. Lord, let me outgrow such childish responses, but not yet, if you please. I added a lined yellow legal pad to the attaché case and outfitted my inside breast pocket with a couple of pens and pencils and a slim leather-bound notebook. My outside breast pocket already held a hanky, which I took out, refolded, and tucked back into place. A phone rang as I walked down the hall to the elevator. It may have been mine. I let it ring. Downstairs, my doorman eyed me with grudging respect. A cab pulled up even as I was lifting a hand to summon it. I gave the balding driver an address on Fifth Avenue between 76th and 77th. He took the 65th Street transverse across Central Park, and while he talked about baseball and Arab terrorists, I watched other runners stepping out the miles. They were at play while I was on my way to work, and how frivolous their pastime seemed to me now. I stopped the cab a half block from my destination, paid and tipped and got out and walked. I crossed Fifth Avenue and mingled with the crowd at the bus stop, letting myself have a good look at the impregnable fortress, because that's what it was. It was a massive, brawny apartment house built between the wars and looming some 22 stories over the park. The Charlemagne, its builder had dubbed it, and its apartments turned up in the real estate section of the Sunday Times every once in a while. It had gone co-op some years back, and when its apartments changed hands now, they did so for six-figure sums. High six-figure sums. From time to time, I would read or hear of someone, a coin collector, let us say, and I would file his name away for future reference. And then I would learn that he lived at the Charlemagne, and I would drop him from my files, because it was akin to learning that he kept all his holdings in a bank vault. The Charlemagne had a doorman and a concierge and attended elevators with closed-circuit television cameras in them. Other closed-circuit devices monitored the service entrance and the fire escapes and God knows what else, and the concierge had a console at his desk where he could, and did, watch six or eight screens at once. The Charlemagne made a positive fetish of security, and while I could readily understand their attitude, you could hardly expect me to approve. A bus came and went, taking with it most of my companions. The light changed from red to green. I hoisted my case full of burglar's tools and crossed the street. The doorman at the Charlemagne made mine look like an usher in a Times Square peep show. He had more gold braid than an Ecuadorian admiral and at least as much self-assurance. He took me in from nose to toes and remained serenely unimpressed. "Bernard Rhodenbarr," I told him. "Mr. Onderdonk is expecting me." Chapter 2. Of course he didn't take my word for it. He passed me on to the concierge and stood by in case I should give that gentleman any trouble. The concierge rang Onderdonk on the intercom, confirmed that I was indeed expected, and turned me over to the elevator operator, who piloted me some 50 yards closer to heaven. There was indeed a camera in the elevator, and I tried not to look at it while trying not to look as though I was avoiding it, and I felt about as nonchalant as a girl on her first night as a topless waitress. The elevator was a plush affair, paneled in rosewood and fitted with polished brass, with burgundy carpeting underfoot. Whole families have lived in less comfortable quarters, but all the same, I was glad to leave it. Which I did on the 16th floor, where the operator pointed to a door and hung around until it opened to admit me. It opened just a couple of inches until the chain lock stopped it, but that was far enough for Onderdonk to get a look at me and smile in recognition. "Ah, Mr. Rhodenbarr," he said, fumbling with the lock. "Good of you to come." Then he said, "Thank you, Eduardo." And only then did the elevator door close and the cage descend. "I'm clumsy tonight," Onderdonk said. "There." And he unhooked the chain lock and drew the door open. "Come right in, Mr. Rhodenbarr, right this way. Is it as pleasant outside as it was earlier? And tell me what you'll have to drink. Or I've a pot of coffee made, if you'd prefer that." "Coffee would be fine." "Cream and sugar?" "Black, no sugar." "Commendable." He was a man in his 60s, with iron gray hair parted carefully on the side and a weathered complexion. He was on the short side and slightly built, and perhaps his military bearing was an attempt to compensate for this. Alternatively, perhaps he'd been in the military. I somehow didn't think he had ever served as a doorman or an Ecuadorian admiral. We had our coffee at a marble-topped table in his living room. The carpet was an aubusson, and the furniture was mostly Louis XV. The several paintings, all 20th-century abstracts in uncomplicated aluminum frames, were an effective contrast to the period furnishings. One of them, showing blue and beige amoeboid shapes on a cream field, looked like the work of Hans Arp, while the canvas mounted over the Adam fireplace was unmistakably a Mondrian. I don't have all that good an eye for paintings, and I can't always tell Rembrandt from Halls or Picasso from Braque, but Mondrian is Mondrian. A black grid, a white field, a couple of squares of primary colors. The man had a style, all right. Bookshelves ran from floor to ceiling on either side of the fireplace, and they accounted for my presence. A couple of days ago, Gordon Kyle Onderdonk had walked in off the street, dropping in at Barnegat Books as casually as someone looking to buy drums in our street or sell Lepidoptery. He'd browsed for a spell, asked two or three reasonable questions, bought a Lewis Auchincloss novel, and paused on his way to the door to ask me if I ever appraised libraries. "I'm not interested in selling my books," he said. "At least I don't think I am, although I'm considering a move to the West Coast, and I suppose I'd dispose of them rather than ship them. But I have things that have accumulated over the years, and perhaps I ought to have a floater policy to cover them in case of fire. And if I ever do want to sell, why, I ought to know whether my library's worth a few hundred or a few thousand, oughtn't I?" I haven't done many appraisals, but it's work I enjoy. You can't charge all that much, but the hourly return is greater than I get sitting behind the counter at the store, and sometimes the chance to appraise a library turns into the opportunity to purchase it. "Well, if it's worth $1,000, a client may say, what'll you pay for it?" "I won't pay $1,000, I may counter, so tell me what you'll take for it." Ah, the happy game of haggling. I spent the next hour and a half with my legal pad and a pen, jotting numbers down and totting them up. I looked at all of the books on the open walnut shelves that flanked the fireplace, and in another room, a sort of study, I examined the contents of a bank of glassed-in mahogany shelves. The library was an interesting one. Onderdonk had never specifically collected anything, simply allowing books to accumulate over the years, culling much of the chaff from time to time. There were some sets in leather, a nice Hawthorne, a Defoe, the inevitable Dickens. There were perhaps a dozen limited editions club volumes, which command a nice price, and several dozen heritage press books, which retail for only $8 or $10, but are very easy to turn over. He had some favorite authors in first editions: Evelyn Waugh, J.P. Marquand, John O'Hara, Wallace Stevens, some Faulkner, some Hemingway, some early Sherwood Anderson. Fair history, including a nice set of Guizot's France and Oman's 7-volume history of the Peninsular War. Not much science, no lepidoptery. He had cost himself money. Like so many non-collectors, he had disposed of the dust jackets of most of his books, unwittingly chucking out the greater portion of their value in the process. There are any number of modern firsts worth, say, $100 with a dust jacket, and $10 or $15 without it. Onderdonk was astonished to learn this. Most people are. He brought more coffee as I sat adding up a column of figures, and this time he had brought along a bottle of Irish mist. "I like a drop in my coffee," he said. "Can I offer you some?" It sounded yummy, but where would we be without standards? I sipped my coffee black and went on adding numbers. The figure I came up with was somewhere in excess of $5,400, and I read it off to him. "I was probably conservative," I added. "I'm doing this on the spot without consulting references, and I shaded things on the low side. You'd be safe rounding that figure off at 6,000. "And what would that figure represent?" "Retail prices, fair market value." "And if you were buying the books as a dealer, presuming, of course, that this type of material was something you were interested in..." "I would be interested," I allowed. "For this sort of material, I could work on 50%. "So you could pay $3,000? I shook my head. "I'd be going with the first figure I quoted you," I said. "I could pay $2,700, and that would include removal of the books at my expense, of course." "I see." He sipped his own coffee, crossed one slim leg over the other. He was wearing well-cut gray flannel slacks and a houndstooth smoking jacket with leather buttons. His shoes might have been of sharkskin. They were certainly elegant and showed off his small feet.
"I wouldn't care to sell now," he said, "but if I do move, and it's a possibility, if not a probability, I'll certainly give your offer consideration."
Books go up and down in value. The price might be higher or lower in a few months or a year.
"I understand that. If I decide to dispose of the books, the primary consideration would be convenience, not price. I suspect I'd find it simpler to accept your offer than to shop around."
I looked over his shoulder at the Mondrian and wondered what it was worth. 10 or 20 or 30 times the fair market value of his library, at a guess. And his apartment was probably worth 3 or 4 times as much as the Mondrian, so $1,000 more or less for some old books probably wouldn't weigh too heavily on his mind.
"I want to thank you," he said, getting to his feet. "You told me your fee. Did you say $200?
"That's right." He drew out a wallet, paused.
"I hope you don't object to cash," he said.
"I never object to cash."
"Some people don't like to carry cash. I can understand that. These are perilous times."
He counted out 4 50s, handed them to me. I took out my own wallet and gave them a home. "If I could use your phone..."
"Certainly," he said,
and pointed me to the study. I dialed a number I'd dialed earlier, and once again I let it ring a dozen times, but somewhere around the 4th ring I chatted into the mouthpiece as if someone were on the other end. I don't know that Onderdonk was even within earshot of me, but if you're going to do something, you might as well do it right. And why call attention to myself by holding a ringing phone to my ear for an unusually long time? Caught up in my performance, I suppose I let the phone ring more than a dozen times, but what matter? No one answered it, and I hung up and returned to the living room. "Well, thanks again for the business," I told him, returning my legal pad to my attaché case. "If you do decide to add a floater to your insurance coverage, I can give you my appraisal in writing if they require it. And I can adjust the figure higher or lower for that purpose as you prefer."
"I'll remember that." And do let me know if you ever decide to get rid of the books. I certainly will. He led me to the door, opened it for me, walked into the hall with me. The indicator showed the elevator to be on the ground floor. I let my finger hover over the button, but avoided pressing it. I don't want to keep you, I said to Onderdonk. It's no trouble, he said. But wait, is that my phone? I think it is. I'll just say goodbye now, Mr. Rhodenbarr. We shook hands quickly, and he hurried back inside his apartment. The door drew shut. I counted to 10, darted across the hall, yanked open the fire door, and scampered down 4 flights of stairs. Chapter 3. At the 11th floor landing, I paused long enough to catch my breath. This didn't take long, perhaps because of all those half-hour romps in Riverside Park. Had I known running would be such a help to my career, I might have taken it up years ago. How did 4 flights of stairs get me from 16 to 11? No 13th floor. But you knew that, didn't you? Of course you did. The fire door was locked from the stairs side. Another security precaution. Tenants, and anyone else, could go down and out in case of fire or elevator failure, but they could only leave the stairs at the lobby. They couldn't get off at another floor. Well, that was nice enough in theory, but an inch-wide strip of flexible steel did its work in nothing flat. And then I was easing the door open, making sure that the coast, or at least the hallway, was clear. I traversed the hallway to 11B. No light showed under the door, and when I pressed my ear against it, I couldn't hear a thing, not even the roar of the surf. I didn't expect to hear anything, since I'd just let the phone in 11B ring 12 or 20 times, but burglary is chancy enough, even when you don't take chances. There was a bell, a flat mother-of-pearl button set flush against the door jamb, and I rang it and heard its sound within. There was a knocker, an Art Nouveau affair in the shape of a coiled cobra, but I didn't want to make noise in the hallway. I didn't indeed want to spend an unnecessary extra second in that hallway, and with that in mind, I bent to my task. First, the burglar alarm. You wouldn't think one was necessary at the Charlemagne, but then you probably don't have a house full of objets d'art and a stamp collection on a par with King Farouk's, do you? If burglars don't take unnecessary chances, why should their victims? You could tell there was a burglar alarm because there was a keyhole for it, set in the door at about shoulder height, a nickel-plated cylinder perhaps 5/8 of an inch in diameter. What man can lock, man can unlock, and that's just what I did. There's a handy little homemade key in my ring that fits most locks of that ilk, and with just the littlest bit of filing and fiddling, it can make the tumblers tumble and... Oh, but you don't want to know all this technical stuff, do you? I thought not. I turned the key in the lock and hoped that was all you had to do. Alarm systems are cunning devices with no end of fail-safe features built in. Some go off, for example, if you cut the household current. Others get twitchy if you turn the key in other than the prescribed fashion. This one seemed docile, but what if it was one of those silent alarms ringing nastily away downstairs or in the offices of some home protection agency? Ah, well. The other lock, the one that was keeping the door shut, was a poulard. According to the manufacturer's advertisements, no one has ever successfully picked the poulard lock. I'd walk into his offices and dispute that claim, but where would it get me? The lock mechanism's a good one, I'll grant them that, and the key's complicated and impossible to duplicate. But I have more trouble on average with your basic Rabsin. Either I picked the poulard or I made myself very long and narrow and slithered in through the keyhole, because within 3 minutes I was inside that apartment. I closed the door and played my pencil beam flashlight over it. If I'd made some grave error knocking off the burglar alarm, and if it was the sort that was ringing in some agency's office, then I had plenty of time to get away before they came calling. so I examined the cylinder to see how it was wired in and if anything seemed to have gone awry, and after a moment or two of frowning and head-scratching, I started to giggle, because there was no alarm system. All there was a nickel-plated cylinder attached to nothing at all, mounted in the door like a talisman. You've seen those decals on car windows warning of an alarm system? People buy the decals for $1, hoping they'll keep car thieves at bay, and perhaps they do. You've seen those signs on houses, beware of the dog, and they haven't got a dog? A sign's cheaper than rabies shots in Alpo, and you don't have to walk it twice a day. Why install a burglar alarm at a cost of $1,000 or more when you could mount a cylinder for a couple of bucks and get the same protection? Why have a system you'd forget to set half the time and forget to turn off the other half of the time when the illusion of a system was every bit as effective? My heart filled with admiration for John Charles Appling. It was going to be a pleasure to do business with him. I'd been reasonably certain he wasn't home. He was at the Greenbrier in White Sulphur Springs, West, by God, Virginia, playing golf and taking the sun and attending a tax-deductible convention of the Friends of the American Wild Turkey, a band of conservationists dedicated to improving wilderness conditions to create a more favorable habitat for the birds in question, thereby to increase their numbers to the point where the Friends can hie themselves off to the woods in autumn with shotgun and turkey lure in tow, there to slay the object of their affections. After all, what are Friends for? I locked the door now, just in case, and I drew my rubber gloves from my attaché case and pulled them on, then took a moment to wipe the surfaces I might have touched while checking the fake alarm cylinder. There still remained the outside of the door, but I'd smudge those prints on the way out. Then I took another moment to lean against the door and let my eyes accustom themselves to the darkness and, let's admit it, to enjoy the feeling. And what a feeling it was. I read once of a woman who spent every free moment at Coney Island riding the big roller coaster over and over and over. Evidently, she got the thrill from that curious pastime that I get whenever I let myself into another person's place of residence. That charged-up sensation, that fire in the blood, every cell alive feeling. I've had it ever since I first broke into a neighbor's house in my early teens, and all the intervening years. All the crimes and all the punishments have not dulled or dimmed it in the slightest. It's as much of a thrill as ever. I'm not boasting. I take a workman's pride in my skills, but no pride at all in the forces that drive me. God help me, I'm a born thief, the urge to burgle bred in my bones. How could they ever rehabilitate me? Can you teach a fish to leave off swimming? A bird to renounce flight? By the time my eyes had grown accustomed to it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.